Thank you, Pastor Tom.
Shalom. Hey, very good. Some churches, they don't really get that. Yeah, when you say shalom to someone, you say shalom back. You know what that means? It means peace. It means hello. It also means goodbye. And I not only came all the way from New York, but I really came from the Holy Land. Because, did you guys know how many Jewish people live in New York City? Over 2 million Jewish people live in New York City. I live in Brooklyn, which is one of the 5 boroughs of New York City. If you've visited New York, perhaps you've only gone to Manhattan. If you ever come again, come down to the better borough, down in Brooklyn, where we have, well, it's just a lot better than Manhattan. You go out there to have your family after you get kicked out of the big high-rises because they cost $4,000 a month to get a Cracker Jack box. And so in Brooklyn, we have about 800,000 Jewish people. And many of them are very Orthodox, very religious. You can see the men because they've got the black suit on and the top hat, and you can tell the women because they've got a wig and they've got long sleeves. And that's where I serve. And I serve with Chosen People Ministries, which is a 125-year-old mission to the Jewish people. And I'll share a little bit more about our background in a sec. But first, I wanted to just share with you guys that I love preaching in Calvary Chapels because Calvary Chapel was the way that God gave me a passion for the salvation of the Jewish people. I had grown up with my parents taking me to great Bible-believing churches, and I actually have a great blessing tonight because I have my mother here. Raise your hand, Mom. My mom lives in Southern California, but she grew up in Salem. And so when she heard that I was going to be doing a preaching tour in the Salem area, she says, well, I want to spend some time with my son. So here she is tonight. And she and my dad took us to great Bible-believing churches all growing up. We had a great a heart for the future of the Jewish people and prophecy in Israel, but it wasn't really a focus of mine. It wasn't really an interest of mine until I went to Israel with my Calvary Chapel in college. And while I was there in Israel, God totally broke my heart for the salvation of the Jewish people. I went back to California and started meeting with my pastor, who had this infectious love for the Jewish people. And I caught his bug. And so now here I am, years later, now a missionary to the Jewish people with Chosen People Ministries. And here's my family up here. They're all back on the East Coast now. So I've got my wife, Liz. We've been married for almost 12 years. And our daughter, Natalie, who just turned 5. And David, who's 2.5. And they're really cute and lots of fun. And pray for my wife because she's alone with them. But she's doing okay so far. So these are some of the people that live around where I serve. These are the kinds of Jewish people that I was telling you about before. You know what that man in the upper left is reading? Is he reading the Bible? Is he reading the Torah? No, he is reading the Talmud. The Talmud is the rabbinic traditions about what Jews should believe. It is talking about the Bible, but it is not the Bible. It is rabbinic tradition, rabbinic controversies and arguments, and ways of living life, and that is just one book out of an entire shelf of books that are all make up the Talmud. And so for me to reach out to people like this, I can't just go straight to the Old Testament. I can't just go straight to the Torah, because he's reading the Torah through the lens of those books. Then you've got some men on the lower right going off to their synagogue. They would call it a shul in Yiddish. And the men are wearing these really expensive fox fur hats, which is a very festive hat to wear on Sabbath days. And then you've got probably their sisters who are behind them. Chosen People Ministries is in 17 different countries all around the globe. We have our headquarters in Manhattan, New York. But we're all over the world. Wherever there is a Jewish population center, We want to have missionaries on the ground sharing the gospel with Jewish people because our mission statement is to pray for, evangelize, disciple, and serve Jewish people and to help fellow believers do the same. And so that's part of the reason why we come out and we preach in churches, because I know that wherever I preach, some of you have Jewish friends, Jewish family members, you have people in your life, and I don't have those relationships. You have those relationships. So I want to encourage you as believers to be missionaries to the Jewish people in your life. And if you don't know anybody yet who's Jewish, then pray, and maybe God will bring someone by your path. And so we want to get the gospel to Jewish people everywhere they are. And one of the ministries that we do is an online ministry called I Found Shalom. And this is where we invite Jewish believers to share their testimony of how they came to faith in Yeshua, or Jesus, as the Messiah. And so I've got a video here to share with you guys.
I want to tell you a story.
I used to believe that Jesus was a Catholic God, God of the Gentiles.
I imagined that Jesus was Italian.
The New Testament was one of those books that I saw nuns reading on the subway.
I was expecting to find a handbook on how to persecute the Jews. I'm reading a story written by Jews about Jewish people.
One thing you don't do is you don't talk about Jesus.
I'm gonna get ostracized. They're gonna think I'm crazy. And
are you out of your mind? You're not Jewish anymore.
Absolutely not. Do not look into this.
You are a traitor to your people.
Jesus was the Messiah.
He wants relationship. He wants fellowship. Believing in Jesus is the most Jewish thing I can do.
I mean, to have a close relationship with God, the truth is worth it. Life with Yeshua would be worth it.
You see, oftentimes when we think of Jewish people, we think of them by default as not believing in Jesus. To be Jewish is to reject Jesus. And what we are trying to do as a ministry is to not only share the gospel with Jewish people, but also tell the stories of Messianic Jews, Jews who believe in Jesus as the Messiah, to make it known that you can be Jewish and believe in Jesus at the same time. And somewhere along the line, in the last 2,000 years, we've forgotten that that can be a reality. As if Jesus was not Jewish, Paul was not Jewish, as if all the disciples were not Jewish. They all believed in Jesus, and yet they were still Jews. And so it is our passion to share this good news and how you can be a Jew who believes in Jesus. Because like my friend Toby said there in the video, what better way can you be Jewish than by believing in the Jewish Messiah? And so I hope that those testimonies encouraged you. If you want to watch them in full, they're about 5 to 7 minutes apiece. They're really well done, well edited. You can go to ifoundshalom.com. We have over 90 of these testimonies filmed. You can sit at your computer or on your iPad, get a box of tissues, and you can just be blessed hearing these stories of Jewish men and women and their stories of coming to faith in Jesus as the Messiah. As I said, we have been around for 125 years. We were founded by a rabbi who came to Lower Manhattan in 1892, got saved after going to a church, a Presbyterian church that was preaching the gospel, and 2 years later he founded our mission. And it's wonderful that we still have a presence in Brooklyn, and we've expanded much more beyond that in the last 125 years. Now, my ministry is a little bit different. My ministry in particular is called Chosen People Answers. It is a sub-ministry of Chosen People Ministries. And my passion is apologetics, which is the defense of our faith in Jesus. I'm the kind of guy that if you have hard questions, I love hearing them because I want to answer them. Some people, I know it's a little intimidating. Someone comes up to you and they're an atheist. And why do you believe in God? Or how do you know the New Testament is true? Why do you side on all these social issues in this way? And you're like, talk to Pastor Tom. Well, I'm not that kind of guy. I want to handle those things head on. And Jewish people have very unique objections as to why they do not believe in Jesus as the Messiah. And so my ministry is to respond and to answer lovingly with scriptural background, with philosophical background, with historical background, to be able to provide a reason for the hope that we have in Yeshua the Messiah. And so, let's see if this is working here. The next generation is not using old media like books, newspapers, radio, and TV. I'm speaking as an older millennial, and I know how all other millennials are learning things. They're not going to old media. Now, the funny thing is that as a 125-year-old ministry, we've been around since the invention of many of these things. We had to learn how to use radio for the gospel. We had to learn how to use the TV for the gospel. Well, where are they today? They're on the internet. Now, when Paul wanted an audience, say in Acts chapter 17, he went to the synagogues if he wanted to speak to Jews, and he went to the marketplaces if he wanted to speak to Gentiles. Well, how do we apply that to today? I believe that the internet is my synagogue. That is the place where I can reach Jewish people for the Lord. I can't waltz into an actual synagogue, but I can go on the internet to the places where Jewish people are congregating digitally, and I can respond to them, and I can invite them to be in conversation with me. We need to reach the next generation of Jewish people because they're on the internet. That's where they're spending their time. And so I'm leading the charge in Chosen People Ministries to be the first digital missionary with our ministry, because this is evangelism in the 21st century. If I were to go in Brooklyn, set up a book table such as this, put all kinds of books, evangelistic books on it, in front of a busy subway station, do you know what all the Jewish people in my neighborhood would do? Walk on the other side of the street. Sometimes they even come by and they spit on the books. They know exactly what I am doing. They are told from the cradle, stay away from the missionaries. So, how do you get the gospel to people like that? How do you do it out on the street corners? They know exactly, or they think they know exactly what you're doing, and they want none of it. Well, some of those very people are going to Google, and they're typing in questions to Google that they would never ask their rabbi. Is Jesus the Jewish Messiah? What does Christianity teach? What are Messianic Jews? They're asking those questions on the internet. Those are the very people that I am trying to reach, the next generation of Jewish people on the internet. So my particular ministry, Chosen People Answers, is a new kind of way of sharing the gospel. It includes a comprehensive scope of apologetics articles written to an unbelieving Jewish audience. It also has a cutting-edge interactive website built on the principles of social media and video games. Just to put it simply, if any of you are Facebook users, I'm basically building Facebook for discussing Jesus with Jewish people. That's the vision, where people can come to the website and they can share their mind and they can like things and they can dislike things and they can be a part of a digital community learning about who Jesus is. It also serves as a platform for true 21st century digital evangelism. I'm trying to do something that this new media called the internet enables us to do. If we don't shift to the new internet way of reading and learning, and we just stick with the old ways, then we're going to miss this next generation. They're not watching TV. They're getting Netflix. They don't even get cable anymore. They're not watching cable news. They're not doing newspapers. That's why they're all going out of business. We have to reach them in the way that they want to be reached in. And so we've got a video here to share what I'm doing. See, and that's okay, but basically it was showing a website that is very interactive, that has all kinds of digital texts on there. We've got the Bible, we've got the Talmud that I was talking about before. You can ask a question on any verse in the entire Bible, Old Testament, New Testament, and our digital missionary team can respond to that question, and then everybody can see it. You could go to Isaiah 53, click on verse 3, and you could see all the questions that have been answered by our digital missionary team before. You can also read a huge encyclopedia of apologetics articles that are all dealing with objections that Jewish people have about Jesus as the Messiah. And so that is my passion, is building this website and building this next generation vision for reaching Jewish people online. The first question that I normally get is, well, Brian, I want to go to this website. It is available, and it's actually not. It's still under construction. I've been working on this for 4 years straight, and we're getting close to being launched, but we're not there yet. And that's why I need your guys' prayers. That's why I need you guys. This is a huge undertaking for Chosen People Ministries. We've never done this kind of thing before. And so that's why each of you were given one of these brochures. Why don't you go ahead and pull it out? If you didn't get a brochure, maybe you could raise your hand if you need a brochure. Okay, we got back there. There we go. Pastor Ton's passing them out. If you open it up, you'll see a picture of my family and our biography. And if you open it up all the way, you'll see details about Chosen People Ministries and the different missions trips and opportunities that we offer. And now we're going to do our first ancient Hebrew ceremony of the night. We're going to be doing lots of ancient Hebrew ceremonies tonight, okay? But this is the first one, okay? Loosely translated from the Hebrew, it's rip the slip, okay? So on the count of three in Hebrew, we're going to find the perforated edge and we're all going to rip together. Echad, shtaim, shalosh. I hope you did better than I did. Okay? On the side with the large menorah, you'll see that there are some checkboxes there for different things that you may want to have information about and how you can partner with Chosen People Ministries. Perhaps you would like to go on a missions trip to Israel. Perhaps you would like to come on a short-term missions trip to New York. We have a missions trip every single summer called Shalom New York, where you get training in Jewish evangelism every morning, and then you go out in teams all throughout New York City in the afternoon. We do that every single year, and please talk with me if you would like to do that. I'm part of the planning team putting that all together. We're still looking for people to come this summer. If you have a Jewish friend that does not yet know the Lord, but you would like them to, you can put down their name and their home address, and we will send them free evangelistic material in the mail. Now, if you flip to the other side with the small menorah, you'll see that you can sign up to be on my personal prayer letter so that you will know how to pray for me, how to pray for Liz and the kids, how to pray for Chosen People Answers, because like I was saying, I can't do this without the Holy Spirit enabling us and greasing the wheels and allowing all the cogs of the machine, of the website, to all work together. We need the Lord to be a part of this in the planning and also when we launch. Because if the Lord does not build the house, then the laborers build in vain. And so I want to see the Lord doing his work through this website. So you can fill out your name, your home address, and or your email address to receive my monthly prayer letter. And you'll see that there are some more checkboxes down at the bottom there that if you feel like God is calling you to go an even greater step, to get the gospel to the Jew first and also to the Gentile, like Paul said in Romans 1:16, you have an opportunity tonight to join my team as I serve as a missionary to the Jewish people. My salary, my ability to live in New York is fully dependent on the generosity of individuals and families and churches that want to support us as we share the gospel with Jewish people. And so you can indicate that here if you feel like God is calling you to join us on a monthly basis, to join our team. If you need some time to pray about it, perhaps talk to your spouse, then you can take this home, and there's an address on the top there, and you can send this in the mail, and I won't even know that you sent it in, kind of like you don't know your right hand know what your left hand is doing, but I would still be so blessed if you were to join our team. And so you can fill this out tonight, and you can put it in the offering basket at the end, or you can give it to me personally at the table in the foyer at the end of tonight. And I want to highlight two of the books that I brought with me that are available for purchase tonight. The first one is called Isaiah 53 Explained. This goes through the gospel in the Old Testament. This is the chapter in the Old Testament that I want to go to if I have only 5 minutes with a Jewish person. And this book is written by our president, Dr. Mitch Glazer, who's a Jewish man who grew up in New York, written toward an unbelieving Jewish audience. So this is an evangelistic book. This is not for you. This is for unbelieving Jews. But my suggestion is that you pick it up, you read it, and the next Jewish person that you have in your life, you give it to them for free, and then you have a conversation with them. So that's Isaiah 53 Explained. The other book is called Messiah and the Passover, and that is what we are going to be talking about tonight. This book goes much more in depth with the Passover that we are going to celebrate tonight, and it talks about history, it talks about Bible passages, it talks about, it even has a chapter on how you can make your own Passover with recipes. It is a comprehensive book, and I'm just a little bit biased that you really should pick up this book because it starts getting really good at page 99, where there's this chapter called Passover and the Lord's Supper by Brian Crawford. This represents my first published work, and so I'm a little biased that I think you guys should pick this up. So you can get those for sale in the back after we close this evening. So why don't I pray for us, and then we can get into the Passover. Father in heaven, we love you, and we thank you for this special evening where we can come around this table and we can see your Son lifted up in the midst of it. We thank you, Lord, for the salvation that you have brought us through the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. And we pray, Father, that you would send your Spirit and you would enable us all, myself included, to experience the gospel in a way that we have not experienced it in a very long time. Help us, Lord, to see communion in a completely new way. May our partaking of the cup and of the bread never be the same again after what we experience tonight. In the name of Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus, the Messiah, I pray. Amen. Okay, so tonight we are going to be celebrating the traditional Jewish Passover Seder. Seder is a Hebrew word that means order because it takes a lot of ordering and preparation to put everything together on the table. Now, Jewish people have been celebrating this holiday, this festival, for over 3,000 years. ever since God commanded Israel to celebrate it all the way back in Exodus chapter 12. I would encourage you this week to spend some time in Exodus chapter 12, and you will see some of the elements up here on the table right there in the text. This is one of the oldest continuously celebrated religious observances in existence. And Jewish people have been celebrating this year in and year out ever since. It's kind of like the Jewish Thanksgiving, where everybody flies in from all over the country. They all come around the dinner table at home, not in the synagogue, at home. The rabbi doesn't lead this. Dad leads this around their own dinner table. Everyone comes around. You got aunts and uncles, and everybody's excited to celebrate this. Doesn't matter if you're super religious or you're super liberal. You don't even believe in God. Almost every single Jewish person celebrates the Passover Seder in some way because it is just so quintessentially Jewish. But, got a question. Why are we doing that tonight? Why are we celebrating a Jewish festival? Where are we? We're in a church. Now, I'm not Jewish. So why am I leading us in a Passover Seder? How many of you are Jewish? Do we have any Jewish people here? Okay, so we're all Goyim. We're all Gentiles. Why in the world are we celebrating a Jewish Passover Seder? Well, we sometimes think that Christianity is over here and Judaism is way over here and never shall the two meet. Well, I want us to have a different perspective tonight, because what history has done is not what reality is. The historical situation has caused us to see Judaism and Christianity as two different religions, completely separate. But let me help you guys out. Maybe this will help. The Virgin Mary was not a Catholic, and John was not a Baptist, and Jesus was not a Christian. What were they? They were all Jews. And as Jews, they would have celebrated this every single year of their lives. They were intimately familiar with the Jewish Passover Seder. In fact, if Jesus was going to be our sinless Messiah, never sinned, he had to celebrate this every single year because God commanded it in the Torah. All Jews must celebrate this. If Jesus is going to be our sinless Messiah, then you better believe it, he was celebrating Passover every single year. And it goes even beyond that. Because Jesus picked this table, the elements, right up in front of us to talk about his life, his death, and even his resurrection. He did this at the Last Supper, which is where we get communion. But he didn't come up with communion like that. Communion comes from this table. This table already had meaning. It already had significance. And Jesus is saying, this is talking about me. And so tonight we're going to talk about the gospel through the Passover. We are going to experience it, hopefully, in a new way. And so that I hope that by the end of tonight, your experience of Passover and your experience of communion will never be the same again. Now, a traditional Jewish Passover Seder takes around 4 hours to do, so you guys are ready to be here till about 10 tonight, right? No, we are going to do the abbreviated version, okay? We are going to be cutting some things out. We're going to be smoothing over some things. I want to get the highlights, but we're not doing the full shebang, okay? And so if you really are interested in doing the full thing, well, talk to me at the back table, and I can get you some resources. It really does take that long. And actually, in very traditional Jewish households, they do it two nights in a row. Okay, so to begin the Passover Seder, we have to do a whole bunch of preparation. We have to get rid of all of the leaven or the yeast from the house. Now, many people think that actually spring cleaning came from this Jewish tradition, because the Jewish family, especially the mother, has to go all throughout the house and look in all the cupboards and clear out anything, any bread made with yeast. So all the bagels and all the leftover pizza and all of the loaves of bread, they got to be gone out of the house. And then dad comes and he has a feather duster and he has to check for little crumbs and make sure that every single little morsel of bread is out of the house. And so I'm looking around. I don't see any loaves of bread lying around. I don't see any bagels. What you guys call bagels. You guys don't know what real bagels are until you come to New York City. New York bagels are the best. But, so I'm looking around and I'm acting as dad tonight and I'm going to just declare this house clean. So you're not in church anymore, okay? We are all now at home. I know it's kind of hard to believe that I'm your dad, you know, but, you know, I'm your dad tonight and you're all sitting around the table and we are all having a family Seder together. And now that we have gotten rid of all the leavened bread from the house, we can begin. The way that we begin the Passover Seder is by lighting the Passover candles. And that is the role of the woman of the household. And since my mother is in attendance tonight, I'm going to invite my mother, Linda, to come up here. And she is going to light the Passover candles so that we can begin. And this is the role, again, of the woman of the household. I, as dad, cannot do this. This is her honor. She is the one who kickstarts everything. If she doesn't want to start, we can't start. She is given the honor of being able to be the one to start it all off. Thank you, Mom. Now, I think this is really appropriate because, well, light in Judaism means the same thing as light in Christianity. Light is a symbol for God's righteousness, God's holiness, God's purity and perfection. Because if we were to turn off all the lights in our house here, and then we were to light the candles, what wins, the light or the darkness? The light, always. It totally demolishes the darkness. In the same way that God's pure righteousness is so pure that it destroys all evil. There is no evil in God's midst. He always wins against evil. Well, if we sit for a moment and consider that, that should give us pause. Maybe even cause us to be a little afraid. Because we are inviting God's presence by lighting the candles. We're inviting His righteousness to be in our midst. But what else is in our midst, even in our own hearts? Sin. Brokenness. Ways that we have lied and hurt each other. Ways that we have turned our back on God Himself. We are inviting Him to be in our midst, and yet we have oftentimes sinned against Him. If light destroys the darkness, then what does that mean for us? You see, this should be something that really causes us to think about where we stand with God. Can we be in the midst of God's presence or not? Now, through what God has done through His Son, we can stand in God's presence. We can be in the presence of a holy and righteous God. But we're skipping to the end where we're going to talk about the gospel. Jewish people don't have that understanding of how they can be in the presence of God's holiness. So now we've lit the Passover candles and we can begin the Passover. The Passover is structured around four separate cups of wine, and each of them has a special significance. So I've got a cup of wine here, and I said a special Hebrew blessing over it that miraculously turned it into grape juice. So now I have grape juice up here, and I'm going to be drinking from this cup four separate times. Each one has a special significance. This first cup is called the Kiddush, or the cup of blessing, and there is a traditional Hebrew blessing that is sung over it that goes like this. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam borei pri hagafen. And now you're going to learn your next Hebrew word. Amen. Everyone with me. Amen. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, the creator of the fruit of the vine. Amen. Did you guys know that you say a Hebrew word at the end of every single one of your prayers? Have you ever just stopped to think about that? Why in the world are you saying Hebrew at the end of your prayers? Are you Jewish? No, you already told me you're not. Why are you saying Hebrew? Again, this is another hint. This is another reminder. Christianity is Jewish. How did the first Gentiles learn how to pray to the God of Israel? Jewish believers in Jesus, who went to synagogue every single week, prayed prayers that said amen at the end of the prayers, had words like hallelujah. Do you guys know what that means? Praise the Lord. These words were repeated. They're words of the heart. You don't lose those words easily. And so when Jewish believers like Paul and John and Matthew started teaching Gentiles how to pray, they kept the words. They kept the Hebrew. Once again, because Christianity is Jewish. Now is the time in the Passover that we tell the Passover story. We talk about how God rescued his people Israel from the midst of her oppressors, in the midst of slavery in Egypt. And this is a story that Jewish people love hearing every single year. It's because it reminds them of the faithfulness and trustworthiness of God. That when God says that he is going to save his people, he will do it. Because put yourself in the shoes of the Israelites in Egypt. What are you standing in? Mud. What's that you feel on your shoulder? It's a whip. What's that voice that you hear? It's your taskmaster telling you to make bricks faster. Now, you've heard these stories passed on for the last 400 years about how your father Abraham had this vision of God. And he told him that, Abraham, you will be a blessing to all the nations of the earth. I will give you a land. I will give you a people. Well, you've heard those stories. Maybe they're legends. Maybe it didn't really happen. Because look at me, God. I'm a slave. I'm not a blessing to myself, let alone the nations of the earth. What would you think in that moment? Your life is slavery. Did that vision between God and Abraham really happen? Did God really tell those things to your father Abraham? Or maybe it was all just made up. Maybe God doesn't even exist. Maybe we're just deluding ourselves and we're just stuck in our slavery here in Egypt. You see, we all may have been tempted to think those things down in Egypt. But the story of the Passover reminds us and reminds the Jewish people that God did tell those things to Abraham and to Isaac and to Jacob. And he did promise that he was going to rescue his people. And he did promise that he was going to make Israel a blessing to all the families of the earth. And so Jewish people love telling this story because it reminds them that even if their eyes see slavery, even if their backs feel whips, that when God promises something, he will do it. And this encourages Jewish people because they look around where they're at today. It's not as bad today as it was 100 years ago or 300 years ago. But for the last 2,000 years, this story has been such an encouragement to the Jewish people. Think about it. You're in a ghetto in the middle of Europe. Everybody hates you. You're not allowed to work in these professions. You're only allowed to be a moneylender, and everybody hates you for that. Or you're in the concentration camps in Germany. You know what the Nazis have done to your family. You see, this story has been a lifeline for the Jewish people for the last 2,000 years because they have felt exile and slavery and oppression, and yet they have chosen to believe that God has promised a future for Israel. Now, I believe that. I hope you believe that. I know many Calvary Chapels believe in the future of the people of Israel. Not just this state on the far corners of the planet, but the people. Israel lives in Portland. Israel lives in New York City. Israel lives in France. Israel lives in all those countries where we have staff members. I believe that God is one day going to fulfill his promises to all Israel. And one day, Paul says, all Israel will be saved. Now, do I see that today? No. We get less than 1% of Jewish people coming to faith in Jesus in any generation. Less than 1%. That's what my eyes see. But on the other hand, as a missionary, I see that 1%. I see that remnant that is called according to grace, according to Romans chapter 11, and that encourages me to go and to find that 1%, to share the gospel with them. But I know that God has promised even greater things to Israel. And this story reminds me that when God promises something to his people Israel, he will do it. So I hope that this encourages you. I hope that this also helps you to see God's big picture story through the Passover. I would encourage you to read Exodus chapter 12, where we learn about Pharaoh and his stubbornness, and then the plagues that God brought upon the nation of Egypt, and then raising up Moses to take the people out into the desert, and then God gave the Torah, and he gave his people his revelation so they knew his heart and knew how to follow him and how to worship and how to have atonement for their sins. This is a beautiful story. But now, instead of talking about the story through words, like I've just given this very big picture retelling of the story, now let's experience the story through our taste buds, through our experiences, because this table is supposed to be an experience of the Passover story. So, you can see up here that I have all these different elements in these different glass cups. In a traditional Jewish Passover Seder, they don't have them in glass cups here. They have them on this beautiful Passover Seder plate. And you can come up here after the service if you can't see it very well right now. But there are all these compartments, and in each compartment, there is a different Hebrew word for the names of the elements that are up here. And so everybody puts the elements on the plate and then passes them around the table. I don't do that here so that you can actually see the elements instead of them being flat on the table. And the first element that we're going to talk about is the karpas, or the greens. This is typically parsley, and it has to be some kind of green plant because it is a symbol for life. Life is good. Life is beautiful, right? Well, you're supposed to take the symbol of life and dip it into salt water. And then you're supposed to eat it. And it's not supposed to taste good. It's supposed to taste bitter and horrible. Why would we eat such a thing? Why would we take something that symbolizes life and make it taste so horrible? Well, the rabbis say that the reason why is because it is a reminder that life is often full of bitter tears. Even if you are God's chosen people, even if he has made a covenant with your forefathers, that does not mean that you get a free pass out of suffering in life. In fact, if you are God's chosen people, you probably will suffer more than those around you. But this is also a symbol of the hyssop branches that the Israelites used to dip into the lamb's blood and to paint on the doorpost and the lintel of their home that tenth and worst plague where God commanded the Israelites to listen and obey Moses and to put the lamb's blood on their homes so that God would pass over them and not destroy their firstborn sons. That is where we get Passover from. Did Pharaoh and the Egyptians listen? No. And so they lost their firstborn sons. So this is also a reminder of the means of Israel's redemption through the blood of a lamb. Next, we're going to talk about the matzah tash, this bag here. This bag has three compartments, 1, 2, 3, and in each one of the compartments, there is a piece of matzah. The tradition is to go to the middle compartment and to take out that piece of matzah. Now, what is matzah? Matzah is bread made without yeast. So without the yeast, it does not rise. So it stays hard like a cracker. And it is pierced and it is striped because if you don't pierce it, then during the baking process, it will crack. And so you have to perforate it. And there is a traditional Hebrew blessing that is sung over the bread, over the matzah, that goes like this. Baruch ata Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam ha-motzi lechem min ha-aretz. Amen. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who brings up bread from the earth. Amen. Okay. The tradition is to take half of that matzah and to put it back into the middle compartment of the matzah tash. Then you have half of it that is left out. This is no longer matzah. This is now called the afikomen. Everyone say it with me, afikomen. Very good. Now you may think that you just learned your next Hebrew word, but you didn't. It's Greek to you. You just learned a Greek word. Afikomen is really interesting. Jewish people don't know where this tradition comes from. We actually don't have any written record of where it really began. Every Jewish household does this afikomen tradition, but ask them why they do it. I don't know. Tradition, you know, fiddler on the roof, who knows? We just all do it. Well, I think it's really fascinating because Jewish people only spoke Greek for several centuries before Jesus and several centuries after Jesus. That's why the New Testament, written by Jews, was written in the language of Greek. Makes sense. Kind of like many Jewish people speak English today. It's just the common language. So we don't know where this tradition comes from, but most likely it comes during the time of Jesus. Was this on Jesus' Passover Seder table? We don't know for sure, but I believe it was. And I'm going to explain a little bit later why I think this is our communion bread. But we'll get to that later. So the tradition is to take this matzah, which is made without yeast, meaning that it doesn't have any decomposition in it. It doesn't have any fermentation in it. It's kind of symbolizing a sinless piece of bread. That's what yeast symbolizes, the decomposition of sin. And so we've got this piece of matzah, and Dad takes it, and he wraps it in a cloth, a linen cloth, and he goes off into the house, and he hides it somewhere. Shh, you don't see where it is. It's hidden somewhere off in the house. Because after dinner, all the kids go run off into the house to find the hidden afikomen. And whoever brings it back gets a prize from Dad. It's kind of like a Jewish Easter egg hunt. Okay? And so all of them are waiting till the end of dinner to go find the afikomen. So we'll come back to that a little bit later. The next thing we're going to do is the second cup. This is called the cup of judgment. This is where we remind ourselves of the plagues that God brought upon the nation of Egypt. Now, this is not something that Jewish people celebrate. This is not a good thing. So what they do is they take the wine, which is a symbol for joy, and they take their pinky, and they recite the names of each of the plagues and remove a drop of wine from the cup, thereby signifying that the joy of this cup is lowering. You see, the Jewish people are not happy that the Egyptians turned their back on God and Moses. It would have been better if they had repented and listened. And so, repeat after me as I say each of the names of the plagues, and then we can drink the second cup. Repeat after me. Blood. Frogs. Vermin. Flies. Pestilence. Boils. Hail. Locusts. Darkness. Slaying the firstborn. And I'll spare you that same Hebrew blessing over the fruit of the vine. It's the same one. And I'll go ahead and drink. Well done. Well done. Never actually had someone do that before, but you were right on cue. That was great. Okay, the next thing we're going to do is the part of the Seder that you remember the most if you have ever participated in it before. It is the maror, or the bitter herb. And this is where we remind ourselves of the bitterness of slavery. So, because the maror, the bitter herb, is so bitter, and I need to keep preaching up here without me coughing and hacking, I needed to have a sacrificial lamb. And so, Pastor Tom, come on up here. Come on up here, Pastor Tom. He is going to show all of us the bitterness of slavery. The tradition is to take a piece of matzah and to take horseradish and to take a big glob of horseradish on the matzah, and you're supposed to eat it in one bite. Okay, so don't eat it yet, but go ahead and take it, Pastor Tom. Okay, now the rabbis were having a discussion one day, and they said, how do you know that you put enough horseradish on your matzah? And they said, if you don't cry, you didn't put enough on. So, all of us are going to be watching to see how you do in showing us how bitter slavery is. Okay, so go ahead and turn. On the count of three in Hebrew, go ahead and eat. Echad, shtaim, shalosh. Just wait. It'll get those sinuses here in a second. Looks like he likes horseradish. Do you like slavery?
No.
How did that taste?
Terrible.
Terrible. Okay, well, I'm going to have mercy on you now. And I'm going to take a second piece of matzah, and I'm going to dip it in the charoset. Everyone say with me, charoset. Okay, and I'm giving him a big chunk of this because this is made out of apples and nuts and honey, and it's supposed to have a consistency like mortar, because it's supposed to remind you of the mortar that the Israelites made while they were slaves. So go ahead and take a big chunk of that. Go for it. A lot better, right? Yeah, much better. It helps wash that bitterness of slavery down. Very good. Okay, thanks, Pastor Tom. Thanks for being the sacrificial lamb tonight. Now, again, the rabbis were having a discussion one day, and they said, well, why is it that we remind ourselves of slavery with something that tastes so sweet, like the charoset? And they said, well, that is a reminder that even in the darkest of times, even in the most bitter of times, the sweetness of God is near. That God does not leave his people alone, even in the darkest of times. Next thing on the table is this shank bone of a lamb. Now, this is on every single Jewish Passover Seder plate, but it was not on Jesus' Passover table. You see, Jewish people, Ashkenazi Jewish people coming from Europe, they say that it is against Jewish law to eat lamb on Passover. But if you were to read Exodus and Deuteronomy, The Torah requires Israel to eat lamb on Passover. What's going on here? Torah says you must eat lamb. Many Jews today say you shall not eat lamb. What's going on? Well, 2,000 years ago, there was a place called the temple. And the temple was the place where you were supposed to do sacrifices. And Moses said, you shall not sacrifice anywhere else except for the appointed place, which was the temple in Jerusalem. And so Jesus did not have a meatless lamb shank bone on his Seder plate. Instead, he sent Peter and John out ahead of him to go prepare for the Passover, meaning they went and they bought a lamb, they took it to the priests in the temple, and they sacrificed the lamb in accordance with the Torah, and then brought the roast lamb and brought the lamb back to the upper room and roast the lamb, and we know it was on the menu. They all had a lamb dinner at the Last Supper. Well, that was because the temple was standing. Jesus was able to follow the commandment. But Jews today cannot. There is no temple. In 70 AD, the Romans came in and destroyed Jerusalem. And so as a reminder, they take a lamb shank bone and put it on the plate as a reminder that they used to sacrifice lambs on Passover. They also have a hard-boiled egg on the plate, and that is a reminder of the life that used to be sacrificed at the temple. Again, this would not have been on Jesus' Passover table. But these two elements are a reminder to everybody today, especially Jewish people themselves, on how much Judaism has changed. Judaism is not the same today as it was 2,000 years ago, back when Jesus walked and lived and taught and a temple stood. This is a reminder that observance of Judaism has changed so much since the destruction of the temple. Now is the time that we take a break for dinner, so everyone forgets about the elements for a second, and Grandma comes out from the kitchen bringing in chicken dinner, matzo ball soup, gefilte fish, chopped liver, you know, all those foods that you just love. And everyone comes, and this is like the Thanksgiving dinner part of Thanksgiving, where we're all celebrating, we're all eating. And according to Jewish tradition, you are supposed to eat all of the lamb during the dinner. But do most Jewish people eat lamb during dinner on Passover now? No. But they want to still show God that they're trying to fulfill the commandment. So they substitute the command to the matzah. So that means that they try to eat all of the matzah on the table before dinner is over, meaning that by the end of dinner, the only matzah that is left in the house is where? It's hidden. So Dad sends all the kids to go run off into the house, and they find the hidden afikomen, and they come back, and they bring it back to Dad, and Dad takes the linen cloth off of it, and then he breaks it into small little pieces, and he gives it to everybody in attendance. And everybody is supposed to take this piece of matzah and think about how this is going to bring good life, good blessing to you for an entire year, because it is good to follow God in observing the Passover. So this is called the bread of life, because you are thinking about how God's sweetness, his blessing, is going to rest upon you until the next year that you celebrate the Passover. And so everybody eats the afikomen, and then we come to the third cup. This is called the cup of redemption, because now we are no longer slaves in Egypt. Now we are free Israelites out in the desert with God as our king and with Moses as our leader. And we're going to Sinai, and we're getting the covenant, and we're getting the Torah. This is a beautiful time of redemption, and we remind ourselves that we are now free. And we sing the Hebrew blessing, and you should all say amen on cue. Here we go. There you go. Now, what better way to celebrate the redemption from slavery than by having a worship service? So now everybody brings out their Bibles in the Hebrew, not in English. They go to Psalm 113, and they sing and chant Psalm 113 through 118 in the original Hebrew as a family worship service. Same psalms that we have, just in the original language, and they are all psalms praising God for the salvation that he has brought his people through the Passover and through his outstretched arm. And now, at the end of that, then we take the fourth and the final cup of the Passover Seder. This is called the cup of praise, because we're praising God for the salvation that he brought us from Egypt. And we say the Hebrew blessing, and we drink. Very good. I'm going to incorporate that in the future now. I'm going to be doing another, I think, 9 or 10 of these in Oregon over the next week and a half. So, we finished all four cups. We've been through all the elements on the table. There's one last thing that we have to do before the traditional Jewish Passover Seder is complete, and that is for all of us to say in unison, next year in Jerusalem. Because Jewish people believe that one day they're no longer going to be in Sheridan, Oregon, no longer in Portland, no longer in New York City, because God is going to send the Messiah, and he is going to return all the people where? To Jerusalem. And instead of Dad leading the Seder from our dinner table, it's going to be the Messiah leading the Seder from Jerusalem. And so everyone says in unison, next year in Jerusalem, with this eager hope that the redemption that we're all longing for will be here this time next year. So let's all say that in unison. Next year in Jerusalem. And with that, the traditional Jewish Passover Seder is complete. But why do we care? What have we just done? What does this have anything to do with us as believers in Jesus, the Messiah? Well, let me give you a hint. Remember that great dinner, all that gefilte fish that you had, all that chopped liver that you had? After that great dinner, do you remember what we did? We took some bread and we drank some wine. Does that remind you of anything anywhere in the New Testament? Because it should. If you have your Bibles, please go to Luke chapter 22. Luke chapter 22. And we will read about Jesus' Passover Seder. Luke chapter 22, starting in verse 7. Then came the first day of unleavened bread on which the Passover lamb had to be sacrificed. And Jesus sent Peter and John, saying, "Go and prepare the Passover for us so that we may eat it." Now, you know a little bit better now what Jesus was asking his two disciples to do. He had to prepare all of this. He had to send them to the temple and get the lamb like we talked about before. It doesn't say it explicitly in Scripture because it was pretty much well known by Jews back then what you had to do to prepare for the Passover. Now let's go down to verse 14. When the hour had come, Jesus reclined at the table and the apostles with him. And he said to them, "I have earnestly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I say to you, I shall never again eat it until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God." And when he had taken a cup and given thanks, he said, "Take this and share it among yourselves. For I say to you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine from now on until the kingdom of God comes." And when he had taken some bread and given thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, he took the cup after they had eaten, saying, "This cup, which is poured out for you, is the new covenant in my blood." Jesus was taking already existing Jewish traditions, and he was saying, "These are talking about me. These point to me." What was Jesus saying? What is he trying to communicate to us through the bread and through the wine? Let's talk about each. First, the bread. What I hold here is bread made without yeast, symbolizing a sin-free bread. In the same way that the gospel in the Old Testament, Isaiah chapter 53, said that the Messiah would never tell a lie and would never do any violence. Now, how many of you have never told a lie and you've never done any violence? If you raise your hand, liar, you just broke that expectation. All of us have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. But the Messiah, he would not fall short. He would be sinless. In the same way that this bread symbolizes a sin-free bread. But this bread is also pierced. It has to be so that it does not crack during the baking process. In the same way that Isaiah 53, the gospel in the Old Testament, said that he would be pierced for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities, that the punishment that brings us peace was upon him, and by his wounds we are healed. You see, this bread is a reminder of the price of our redemption. It took a sinless, perfect, broken, pierced Messiah to die on our behalf, so that we could have a right relationship with God. So that we could be in the presence of the holy fire of God's righteousness. But this is not just regular bread. This is the afikomen. This is the special matzah. Now, do you guys remember where I got the afikomen? From this bag. Now, do Jewish people know where this tradition comes from? No, they don't. Why is it there's a bag with three compartments? Well, one rabbi says, well, it's probably signifying the patriarchs. You've got Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Another rabbi says, oh, no, you're totally wrong. You're crazy for thinking that. This represents the priests and the Levites and all the other tribes of Israel. But when you get two rabbis arguing about something, they're always going to leave with at least three opinions. Nobody agrees. And so I think that Messianic Jews have right to figure out what the significance of this ancient Jewish tradition is. I believe that this bag is talking about the diversity within the unity of God. We believe in one God, but he exists as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And it was not the Father who bled on the tree. It was not the Holy Spirit who was crushed for our transgressions. It was the second person of the Trinity, God the Son, who was taken, the middle compartment of the matzah tash. And the Father took him and broke him on that cross. And the Father took him and wrapped him in a linen cloth. And hid him in a tomb for 3 days. Now, we know the end of the story. We know not only the end of the gospel story, we also know what happened before in the service. All the kids go run off into the house, and it's always found. The dad knows where it is, and the kids are smart enough to figure out where it is. You knew that the afikomen was coming back. Jesus' disciples didn't know that he was coming back. Now, it's not for a loss of Jesus trying to communicate to them. He said to them over and over again, I am going to Jerusalem, I'm going to be betrayed, I'm going to be killed, I'm going to be buried, and on the third day, I will rise from the grave. Whoosh! Right over the heads of the disciples. They did not get it. When Jesus was hidden in the tomb, they started parting ways, saying we had hoped that he was going to be the Messiah. But obviously he wasn't. But then, on the third day, on the day of Easter, Resurrection Sunday, he was found. And he was given back to his Father. And now his Father takes and gives him to each of us as the true bread of life, who does not bring blessing for 1 year, but for all eternity. Jesus is the broken, pierced, resurrected Messiah for us all. Jesus also took the cup, and he said, "This is the cup of the new covenant in my blood." Now, Jesus is Jewish. He's speaking to a crowd of all Jews in his Passover Seder. Not a single Gentile was at the Last Supper. As Jews, they would have understood what blood and new covenant means. When a Jewish person thinks of blood, they think of one thing. They think of the sacrificial system at the temple. How God enabled innocent animals to take the place of us when we sin. Because when we sin against God, we are turning our back on the giver of life. And if we turn our back on the giver of life, we don't deserve to live anymore. He gives us our life, and yet we are trying to sever our connection with him. So we deserve death. But God is gracious, and he enabled the people of Israel to sacrifice a lamb, a bull, a goat, on their behalf to cover over their sin. But Jesus is not saying this is the blood of lambs and bulls and goats. He's saying this is my blood. Of course, a symbol, because all of this is a symbol. The wine is a symbol for his blood. What does that mean? Well, do you remember what John the Baptist said when he saw Jesus from afar off? He said, "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." Jesus is claiming that his own blood, which is about to be shed just a couple hours after this, is going to be the atoning sacrificial blood, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. But Jesus also said this is the cup of the new covenant. Again, his Jewish audience would have understood what he's talking about, because that phrase is only used once in the Old Testament, in the prophet Jeremiah. Jeremiah said that one day he was going to bring Israel a new covenant, and it was going to be better than all the previous covenants, because Israel kept breaking those covenants. But this new covenant would mean that God forgives the sin of his people. Jesus is saying that the day of the new covenant that was prophesied hundreds of years ago, it's here. Because tomorrow I'm going to bleed and die, and that is going to begin a brand new relationship between God and man. Now, we don't really use the word covenant that often. It's kind of an old English word. So maybe we don't really know what a covenant is. But I hope that we understand what marriage is. Marriage is supposed to be a lifelong agreement between one man and one woman for life. And it is patterned off of the covenants in Scripture. Covenants are unbreakable agreements between two parties, principally between God and man. Jesus is offering a marriage proposal. You see, even in today's society, we understand that if you as the boyfriend are going to propose marriage to your girlfriend, you gotta show her that you are serious. And how do we do that? Well, the boyfriend saves up several months of his income, and what does he do? He buys a really expensive rock, and he puts it on his girlfriend's finger. Now, why a rock? Why do we have this tradition? What does this mean? That really expensive rock symbolizes the fact that the boyfriend was willing to say no to himself. Not buy that new car, not buy that new Xbox, not waste his time on the Xbox, but to save up and to spend money on his future wife to show her, "I am willing to sacrifice for you. I will provide for you. Just like it was hard for me to buy this ring for you, I will show you in the future that I am willing to do what is hard for the future of our family." Now, what if the boyfriend gets down on one knee and he asks, "Honey, will you marry me?" And he whips out a plastic ring from a Cracker Jack box. What would that signify to his girlfriend? Get out of there. He doesn't care about you. He doesn't see you as valuable. He's just doing this off the cuff. He hasn't put forethought into this. Is he really going to be trustworthy for the future? Well, Jesus is doing the exact opposite. Because as he raises this cup, and as he offers a new covenant relationship, he is down on one knee, and he is not offering a ring. He is offering his whole life. That is the price that he is willing to pay to be in relationship with you. He is willing to give everything, far beyond what any of us have given to our spouses. Have you said, "I do," to Jesus? Have you accepted his proposal? You see, because Christianity is not a religion of do's and don'ts. Coming to church, doing what's expected of you, reading your Bible so you know more, being a good person, that is not what Christianity is. Christianity is a marriage relationship, a romance between you and Jesus. And where did it begin? It began when he proposed marriage to you right here. And that is why the New Testament talks about our relationship with Jesus as a marriage. That the church is the bride, and he is the groom. And one day, in Revelation, at the end of Scripture, it says that there's going to be a great marriage supper of the Lamb. Now, did you notice that Jesus said to his disciples, "I will not drink of the fruit of the vine again until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God"? I believe he was holding up the third cup, the cup of redemption, signifying that the new covenant brings redemption from our sins. But he said, "I'm not going to drink of this until there's a fourth cup waiting." There is a fourth cup that will be drunk by Jesus and all of us at the great marriage supper of the Lamb. Have you said, "I do," to him? Have your friends, have your family members said, "I do," to Jesus' marriage proposal? Because that is what we are offering this lost and dying world. And if you have accepted Jesus' marriage proposal, then I want to remind you, or maybe let you know for the first time, what you're doing when you take communion. You are saying to Jesus, "I do," again and again and again. We are reminding ourselves not only of the price of our redemption, but also that we are still married to Jesus, that he is still our Lord, our Master, and our everything. We are renewing our vows to Jesus every single time we take communion. And so may that be at the forefront of your mind whenever you take the cup and the bread. There's one last thing that I want to talk about up here before we close the service, and I have Pastor Tom come up here. Got an empty place setting up here. Got a pillow and a plate and a cup. Every single Jewish household sets up an empty place setting for Elijah, because at a certain place in the Passover Seder, they have one of the kids go to the front door and to look both ways to see if Elijah's there. And if Elijah's there, well, come on in, Elijah. Here's your seat. We've got a place ready for you. Why do Jewish people do this? Well, according to Jewish tradition, Elijah is going to return on the evening of Passover, and he is going to announce the coming of the messianic redemption. And so, every single year, there's this expectation that tonight could be the night, and so we need to have a place ready for him. Now, are Jewish people correct in believing that Elijah is going to come and announce the coming of the Messiah? They actually are. You go to Malachi chapter 3, end of the Old Testament, and you'll see that God talked about Elijah coming and announcing the coming of the day of the Lord. That's why when John the Baptist came preaching and teaching, they kept asking him, "Are you Elijah? Are you Elijah?" They had an expectation that was based in Scripture. And John said, no, I'm not Elijah. You got the wrong guy. But Jesus overruled John. Jesus said that John the Baptist was the Elijah who was to come, and he prepared the way before me. Meaning that Elijah has already come. And the Messiah has already come. That's why this empty chair should break our hearts. Because the Jewish people are looking for an Elijah and a Messiah that has already been here. And yet they've missed him. This shows us that we need to get the gospel to the Jewish people. Because this whole table proclaims the gospel. This is where we get our communion. This is talking about the life and the death and the resurrection of Jesus. And Jewish people who are celebrating this every single year, they don't know that. We need to get the gospel to them. Because they are God's chosen people. And they were the first ones to get the gospel to us. They were the first ones to give us the scriptures, both Old and New Testament. We need to get the gospel back to them. And so that's why I would encourage you to fill out those prayer letters, to stay in touch with me, know how to pray for me, come back to the back table and ask me any questions that you may have. But I just want to thank you for coming out tonight and just being such a great audience and sharing this Jewish Passover Seder with me tonight. I hope that you were blessed. I hope that you were encouraged. And I do hope that you will experience communion in a completely new, completely renewed way from this point on. Thanks so much, Pastor Tom.
So, we are going to have, I'm going to pray for Brian here. If you want to join with me to pray for him. And I would encourage you to be praying for him in his ministry as he goes out there, because he's definitely on the front lines spiritually when he goes out and does this. And after we're done here, if you feel that God's leading you to help support Brian in his ministry, we do have a giving box in the back. I would encourage you, if you could put your offering in there, or you could use the little fancy electronic device that we have up there also. We've got to keep up with that stuff.
Mm-hmm. Right?
So anyway, I want to thank you all for being here tonight, and I want to just take a minute before we go and pray for our brother, okay? Lord, we want to thank you so much. First of all, Lord, for bringing this gentleman here to us to allow us to see so clearly your awesome plan. And Lord, how clear you make it to those who have eyes that can see. And we thank you that this evening we can see so clearly. We see everything, Lord, that you have shown us tonight, and we are so thankful for Jesus, that he would come and fulfill each and every prophecy. And Lord, as Brian goes out and visits other churches and as Resurrection Sunday approaches, Lord, be with him and bless him and bless his family, Lord. Keep him safe and put a hedge of protection around him, Lord. And we pray that his new internet program, his computer program would flourish, Lord, that people would get the answers that they need to know. We just thank you so much for this opportunity we've had, and we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. So Brian's going to be out in the foyer, correct? If you want to. Does anybody have any questions for him?
Oh, nice. Where have you learned that before? Oh, wonderful. Oh, you're the resident Hebrew expert? Awesome. Wonderful.
Anybody else? Don't be shy. You're all shy. God bless you guys.
Oh, do we have one in the back?
What does a Jewish person do if they're a baker?
If they're a baker?
For
an entire week, you are not allowed to bake anything but matzah. And when your whole Jewish community is all eating matzah with you, you're still in business. Yeah, you just change the kind of bread you're making.
Good question.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Correct.
Yes. So powerful.
Together we sing. Oh.